All right, so for more on this, we want to bring in former 2016 Bernie Sanders surrogate and Democratic activist Nomiki Konst. She's also a candidate for New York City public advocate. Interesting. We're going to talk a little bit about that. But first, we're going to sort of Bernie Sanders it up. So here he is, round two, right? But it's a little different this time around for him. You know, there are other progressives running. There are, you know, he was able to sort of really capture the youthful vote, but there are younger people running now. How do you think this race is going to be a little different for him this time?
I mean, well, first off, it's likely to be a very crowded field. Mm-hmm. And the Democratic Party's rules are very different than they were, you know, just 4 years ago, the last time around. You don't have one candidate being backed by the institution and basically every elected Democrat in all of the United States. So it will be interesting in terms of factions, but I actually think at the end of the day, what Bernie Sanders has been able to do is solidify the left around a movement. And really, at the end of the day, it's who can defeat Donald Trump. Mm-hmm. And all these other candidates, some are fantastic. Some are younger and newer to the process. Some just want to get their names out. At the end of the day, he's the only person who has literally millions of people organized. He built an organization called Our Revolution that has chapters in every single city across America, counties, rural America, and they've been organizing, recruiting candidates who are probably going to come out and endorse Senator Sanders now in this election. And so the infrastructure is there to compete with the infrastructure that Donald Trump has, which is this movement as well as the Republican Party now unified behind him.
Right. One of the challenges Senator Sanders faced back in 2016 is with African-American voters. Clearly, he was not able to capture as many African-American voters as Hillary Clinton was, and a lot of them were, frankly, turned off in some instances by the back and forth between he and Secretary Clinton. So what's he doing this time around, given that the others in the race represent a far more diverse group of candidates than he certainly has faced in the past?
Sure. I mean, he is from Vermont, and there's no secret there, but what I will say is, in the last 2 years, we've seen Senator Sanders hit the campaign trail. talking about issues like Medicare for all, college for all, debt relief. And these are issues that really are intersectional. And the polling has been very, very strong. He is actually doing very well with African-American vote in different, really all across America right now. The numbers have shot up astronomically. I mean, he is probably polling better than most of the candidates right now. And then when you look at under the age of 45, he is winning with people of color and young women especially. So it's interesting to see where the polls are right now.
Yeah, I mean, he has just, I think recently he said, you know, it's about the issues that matter to all Americans. But there are some people who are going to say, no, today in 2019, there are issues that are specifically affecting people of color, people who are LGBTQ, and we want a candidate who addresses that and understands that.
But I also feel like, you know, when he ran last time around, some of his ideas were sort of considered radical, you know, when we talk about Medicare for all or whatever. And now we're hearing that pop up with other candidates already. The phrasing's a little different here and there. No one's really saying single payer, but they're kind of coming around to something like that. And I wonder if it's going to be more challenging for him to stand out, even though he has the name recognition. He doesn't seem as, for lack of a better word, radical.
That's good, though.
In this crowd?
It's good that we have shifted the conversation so much to be less about how are we going to pay for it when we're giving away huge tax breaks to the world's wealthiest people. And then it's like, well, how can we pay for policies and ideas that will help working people?
Right.
So I think he's been able, with other leaders, to shift that narrative. It is wonderful that Senator Warren and Senator Kamala Harris and Cory Booker all signed on to Medicare for All.
Right.
That is good for the United States. I think that's his agenda. There are plenty of ideas out there that are going to help working people, and I have no doubt that Senator Sanders and possibly Senator Warren as well will be putting those ideas out on the table before everybody else.
The question I guess a lot of people are going to have, given we have such a wide field right now on the Democrat side, is can you beat Donald Trump?
Right.
That's the question. And I'm, you know, obviously as a supporter of Bernie Sanders in the past, you probably believe that he can. But what is it that is going to electrify voters to defeat the president at the polls?
Right. It's the economy, stupid. It's the old line from, you know, Bill Clinton, from James Carville. It is the economy, stupid. It's about talking about what is going to make your life as an American better, more affordable. Income inequality is worse than any other time in history. We're talking 1929, the stock market collapsed, 2008. It's worse today than it was back then. So at the end of the day, Howard Schultz needs to take a back seat about, you know, as Bernie Sanders says, blackmailing the Democratic Party. Right. Interesting choice of words. and really talking about how are you going to help people's lives. And that's what I think is the central theme of Senator Bernie Sanders' message, his campaign in 2016, and hopefully his campaign in 2020 as well.
So listen, you're running.
I am. It's
Switch
crazy
gears.
For
yeah.
public
yeah.
advocate. So you got to tell me, why did you decide to jump into this crazy business in this way as a candidate? You know, what are you hoping to accomplish? Why did you want to run?
So the Office of Public Advocate is unique. It's a newer office. It's second in line to the mayor, but it's the watchdog of the city. It's there to make sure that all the agencies of New York and the city council and the mayor are doing their jobs and are being investigated. My background, before I was on the Senator Sanders bandwagon, I was actually an investigative reporter. I started here in New York City with some famous investigative reporters covering New York City government, state government, and then I've done work in, you know, Flint with the lead crisis. We have a huge lead problem here in New York. I was in Puerto Rico for much of the last year covering the aftermath of Puerto Rico with CBS News. You guys were great there on the ground as well. So I think, you know, this job at this point in history in New York City, I just talked about the income inequality being worse than any other time in history. In New York, it's actually the worst in the country. Mm. And at the end of the day, we have real estate developers who have been unregulated since the mid-70s, and they are making it very unaffordable for working people who are being driven out of their communities, and they have a strong relationship with our lawmakers in New York City. And so the job of public advocate, in my opinion, is really to be a check on special interests, to be a check on our elected officials who promised to deal with income inequality, the tale of two cities. But really, it's only gotten much, much worse for everyday New Yorkers.
And for New Yorkers, when should they vote?
February 26th, 1 week away. Nomiki Konst.
Nomi, they're so great to see
Thank
you.
Thank you. So great
Good
to
luck.
See you.
Thank you.